Section 24 of 4 and 20 Fairy Tales. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Story of the Beauty and the Beast by Madame de Villeneuve, translated by James Lushy. Part 6. The king, accompanied by his daughter and the prince, was ushered by the monkey officers into the apartment destined for him by the fairy, who took this opportunity of restoring to the statues the liberty of relating what they had witnessed. As their fate had excited the compassion of the queen, it is from her hands that the fairy desired they should receive the benefit of reanimation. She placed her wand in the queen's hand, who, by her instructions, described with it 7 circles in the air, and then pronounced these words: "Be reanimated. Your king is restored to you." All the statues immediately began to move, walk, and act as formerly, retaining only a confused idea of what had happened to them. After this ceremony, the fairy and the queen returned to the king, whom they found in conversation with Beauty and the prince, caressing each in turn, and most fondly his daughter, of whom he inquired 100 times how she had been preserved from the wild beast who had carried her off, without remembering that she had answered him from the first time that she knew nothing about it, and had been ignorant even of the secret of her birth. The prince also talked without being attended to, repeating 100 times the obligations he was under to Princess Beauty. He desired to acquaint the king with the promises which the fairy had made him, that he should marry the princess, and to beg he would not refuse his cheerful consent to the alliance. This conversation and these caresses were interrupted by the entrance of the queen and the fairy. The king, who had recovered his daughter, fully appreciated his happiness, but was as yet ignorant to whom he was indebted for this precious gift. "It is to me," said the fairy, "and I alone can explain to you the adventure. I shall not limit my benefits to the recital of that alone. I have other tidings in store for you, not less agreeable. Therefore, great king, you may note this day as one of the happiest of your life." The company, perceiving that the fairy was about to commence her narration, evinced by their silence the great attention they were anxious to pay to it. To satisfy their curiosity, the fairy thus addressed the king: "Beauty, my liege, and perhaps the prince, are the only persons present who are not acquainted with the laws of the Fortunate Island. It is necessary I should explain those laws to them. The inhabitants of that island, and even the king himself, are allowed perfect liberty to marry according to their inclinations, in order that there may be no obstacle whatever to their happiness. It was in virtue of this privilege that you, sire, selected for your wife a young shepherdess, whom you met one day when you were hunting. Her beauty and her good conduct were considered by you deserving of that honor. You raised her to the throne, and placed her in a rank from which the lowliness of her birth seemed to have excluded her, but of which she was worthy. By the nobleness of her character and the purity of her mind, you know that you had continual reasons to rejoice in the selection you had made. Her gentleness, her obliging disposition, and her affection for you equaled the charms of her person, but you did not long enjoy the happiness of beholding her. After she had made you the father of Beauty, you were under the necessity of travelling to the frontiers of your kingdom, to suppress some revolutionary demonstrations of which you had received intimation. During this period you lost your dear wife, an affliction which you felt the most sensibly, because in addition to the love with which her beauty had inspired you, you had the greatest respect for the many rare qualities that adorned her mind. Despite her youth and the little education she had received, you found her naturally endowed with profound judgment, and your wisest ministers were astonished at the excellent advice she gave you and the policy by which she enabled you to succeed in all your undertakings. The King, who still brooded over his affliction, and to whose imagination the death of that dear wife was ever present, could not listen to this account without being sensibly affected. And the Fairy, who observed his emotion, said, "Your feelings prove that you deserved that happiness. I will no longer dwell on a subject that it is so painful to you, but I must reveal to you that the supposed shepherdess was a fairy, and my sister, who, having heard that the Fortune Island was a charming country, and also much praise of its laws and of the gentle nature of your government, was particularly anxious to visit it. The dress of a shepherdess was the only disguise she assumed, intending to enjoy for a short time a pastoral life. You encountered her in her new abode. Her youth and beauty touched your heart. She yielded to a desire to discover whether the qualities of your mind equaled those she found in your person. She trusted to her condition and power as a fairy, which could place her at a wish beyond the reach of your assiduities, if they became too importunate, or if you should presume to take advantage of the humble position in which you found her. She was not alarmed at the sentiments with which you might inspire her, and persuaded that her virtue was sufficient to guarantee her against the snares of love. She attributed her sensations to a simple curiosity to ascertain if there were still upon the earth men capable of loving virtue unembellished by exterior ornaments, which rendered it more brilliant and respectable to vulgar souls than its own intrinsic merit, and frequently, by their fatal attractions, obtained the reputation of virtue for the most abominable vices. Under this illusion, far from retreating to our common asylum, as she had at first proposed, she chose to inhabit a little cottage she had raised for herself in the solitude in which you met her, accompanied by a phantom representing her mother. These two persons appeared to live there upon the produce of a pretended flock that had no fear of the wolves, being in fact genii in that form. It was in that cottage she received your attentions, which produced all the effect you could desire. She could not resist the offer you made her of your crown. You know now the extent of the obligations you were under to her at a time when you imagined she owed everything to you, and were satisfied to remain in that error. What I now tell you is a positive proof that ambition had no share in the consent she accorded to your wishes. You are aware that we look upon the greatest kingdoms but as gifts which we can bestow on anyone at our pleasure. But she appreciated your generous behavior in esteeming herself happy in uniting herself to so excellent a man. She rashly entered into that engagement without reflecting on the danger which she thereby incurred. For our laws expressly prohibit our union with those who have not as much power as ourselves, more especially when we have not arrived at that age when we are privileged to exercise our authority over others, and enjoy the right of presiding in our turn. Previous to that time we are subordinate to our elders, and that we may not abuse our power, we have only the liberty of disposing of our hands in favour of some spirit or sage, whose knowledge is at least equal to our own. It is true that after that period we are free to form what alliance we please, but it is seldom that we avail ourselves of that right, and never without scandal to our order. Those who do are generally old fairies, who almost always pay dearly for their folly, for they marry young men who despise them, and although they are not punished as criminals, they are sufficiently punished by the bad conduct of their husbands, on whom they are not permitted to avenge themselves. It is the only penalty imposed upon them, the disagreements which almost inevitably follow the indiscretion they have committed, takes from them the desire of revealing to those profane persons, from whom they expected respect and attention, the great secrets of art. My sister, however, was not placed in either of these positions. Endowed with every charm that could inspire affection, she was not of the required age, but she consulted only her love. She flattered herself she could keep her marriage a secret. She succeeded in so doing for a short time. We rarely make inquiries about those who are absent. Each is occupied with her own affairs, and we fly through the world, doing good or ill, according to our inclinations, without being obliged at our return to account for our actions, unless we have been guilty of some act which causes us to be talked about, or that some beneficent fairy, moved by the unjust precaution of some unfortunate mortal, lays a complaint against the offender. In short, there must arise some unforeseen event to occasion us to consult the general book, in which all we do is written at the same instant without the aid of hands. Saving these occasions, we have only to appear in the general assembly 3 times in the year, and as we travel very swiftly, the affair does not occupy more than a couple of hours. My sister was obliged to give light to the throne, such is our phrase, for the performance of that duty. On such occasions she arranged for you a hunting party at some distance, or a journey of pleasure, and after your departure she feigned some indisposition to remain alone in her cabinet, or that she had letters to write, or that she wished to repose. Neither in the palace nor amongst us was there any suspicion of that which it was so much her interest to conceal. This mystery, however, was not one for me. The consequences were dangerous, and I warned her of them. But she loved you too much to repent the steps she had taken. Desiring even to justify it in my eyes, she insisted that I should pay you a visit. Without flattering you, I confess that, if the sight of you did not compel me entirely to excuse her weaknesses, it at least diminished considerably my surprise at it, and increased the zeal with which I labored to keep it a secret. Her dissimulation was successful for 2 years, but at length she betrayed herself. We are obliged to confer a certain number of favors on the world generally, and to return an account of them. When my sister gave in hers, it appeared that she had limited her excursions and her benefits to the confines of the Fortunate Island. Several of our ill-natured fairies blamed this conduct, and our queen, in consequence, demanded of her why she had restricted her benevolence to this small corner of the earth, when she could not be ignorant that a young fairy was bound to travel far and wide, and manifest to the universe at large our pleasure and our power. As this was no new regulation, my sister could not murmur at the enforcement of it, nor find a pretext for objecting to obey it. She promised, therefore, to do so, but her impatience to see you again, the fear of her absence being discovered at the palace, the impossibility of acting secretly on a throne, did not permit her to absent herself long enough and often enough to fulfil her promise, and at the next assembly she could hardly prove that she had been out of the Fortunate Island for a quarter of an hour. Our Queen, greatly displeased with her, threatened to destroy that island, and so prevent her continuing to violate our laws. This threat agitated her so greatly that the least sharp-sighted fairy could see to what a point she carried her interest for that fatal island. And the wicked fairy, who turned the Prince here present into a frightful monster, was convinced by her confusion that on opening the great book she should find in it an important entry which would afford some exercise to her propensities for mischief. "It is there," she exclaimed, "that the truth will appear, and that we shall learn what has really been her occupation." And with these words she opened the volume before the whole assembly, and read the details of all that had taken place during the last 2 years in a loud and distinct voice. All the fairies made an extraordinary uproar on hearing of this degrading alliance, and overwhelmed my wretched sister with the most cruel reproaches. She was degraded from our order and condemned to remain a prisoner amongst us. If her punishment had consisted of the first penalty only, she would have consoled herself. But the second sentence, far more terrible, made her feel all the rigor of both. The loss of her dignity little affected her, but loving you fondly, she begged with tears in her eyes that they would be satisfied with degrading her, and not deprive her of the pleasure of living a simple mortal with her husband and her daughter. Her tears and supplications touched the hearts of the younger judges, and I felt from the murmur that arose that if the votes had been collected at that instant, she would certainly have escaped with the reprimand. But one of the eldest, who, from her extreme decrepitude, had obtained amongst us the name of the Mother of the Seasons, did not give the Queen time to speak and admit that pity had touched her heart as well as the others.
"There is no excuse for this crime," cried the detestable old creature in her cracked voice. "If it is permitted to go unpunished, we shall be daily exposed to similar insults. The honor of our order is absolutely involved in it. This miserable being, attached to earth, does not regret the loss of a rank which elevated her 100 degrees higher above monarchs than they are above their subjects. She tells us that her affections, her fears, and her wishes all turn upon her unworthy family. It is through them we must punish her. Let her husband deplore her. Let her daughter, the shameful fruit of her illegal marriage, become the bride of a monster, to expiate the folly of a mother who could allow herself to be captivated by the frail and contemptible beauty of a mortal."
This cruel speech revived the severity of many who had been previously inclined to mercy, those who continued to pity her being too few to offer any opposition. The sentence was approved of in its integrity, and our Queen herself, whose features had indicated a feeling of compassion, resuming their severity, confirmed the majority of votes in favor of the motion of the ill-natured old fairy. My sister, however, in her endeavors to obtain a revocation of this cruel decree, to propitiate her judges, and to excuse her marriage, had drawn so charming a portrait of you that it inflamed the heart of the fairy governess of the Prince, she who had opened the great volume. But this dawning passion only served to increase the hatred which that wicked fairy already bore to your unfortunate wife. Unable to resist her desire to see you, she concealed her passion under the color of a pretext that she was anxious to ascertain if you deserved that a fairy should make such a sacrifice for you as my sister had done, and she had obtained the sanction of the assembly to her guardianship of the prince. She could not have ventured to quit him for any length of time if the ingenuity of love had not inspired her with the idea of placing a protecting genius and two inferior and invisible fairies to watch over him in her absence. After taking this precaution, there was nothing to prevent her following her inclination, which speedily carried her to the Fortunate Island. In the meanwhile, the women and officers of the imprisoned queen, surprised that she did not come out of her private cabinet, became alarmed. The express orders she had given them not to disturb her induced them to pass the night without knocking at the door, but impatience at last taking place of all other considerations, they knocked loudly, and no one answering, they forced the doors, under the impression that some accident had happened to her. Although they had prepared themselves for the worst, they were not the least astonished at perceiving no trace of her. They called her, they hunted for her in vain. They could discover nothing to appease the despair into which her disappearance had plunged them. They imagined 1,000 reasons for it, each more absurd than the other. They could not suspect her evasion to be voluntarily. She was all-powerful in your kingdom. The sovereign jurisdiction you had confided to her was not disputed by anyone. Everybody obeyed her cheerfully. The affection you had for each other, that which she entertained for her daughter and for her subjects, who adored her, prevented them from supposing she had fled. Where could she go to be more happy? On the other hand, what man would have dared to carry off a queen from the midst of her own guards and the center of her own palace? Such a ravisher must have left some indication of the road he had taken. The disaster was certain, although the causes of it were unknown. There was another evil to dread, namely the feelings with which you would receive this fatal news. The innocence of those who were responsible for the safety of the Queen's person by no means satisfied them that they should not feel the effects of your wrath. They felt they must either fly the kingdom and thereby appear guilty of a crime they had not committed, or they must find some means of hiding this misfortune from you. After long deliberation, they could imagine no other than that of persuading you the queen was dead, and this plan they put instantly into execution. They sent off a courier to inform you that she had been suddenly taken ill. A second followed a few hours afterwards, bearing the news of her death. In order to prevent your love inducing you to return post-haste to court, your appearance would have deranged all the measures they had taken for general security. They paid to the supposed defunct all the funeral honors due to her rank, your affection, and the sorrow of a people who adored her and who wept her loss as sincerely as yourself. This cruel adventure was always kept a profound secret from you, although it was known to every other inhabitant of the Fortune Island. The first astonishment had given publicity to the whole affair. The affliction you felt at this loss was proportionate to your love. You found no consolation except in the innocent caresses of your infant daughter, whom you sent for to be with you. You determined never again to be separated from her. She was charming, and presented you continually with a living portrait of the Queen, her mother. The hostile Fairy, who had been the original cause of all this trouble by opening the great book in which she discovered my sister's marriage, had not come to see you without paying the price of her curiosity. Your appearance had produced the same effect upon her heart as it had previously done on that of your wife, and instead of this experience inducing her to excuse my sister, she ardently desired to commit the same fault. Hovering about you invisibly, she could not resolve to quit you. Beholding you inconsolable, she had no hope of success, and fearing to add the shame of your refusal to the pain of disappointment, she did not dare make herself known to you. On the other hand, supposing she did appear, she imagined that by skillful maneuvering she might accustom you to see her, and perhaps in time induce you to love her. But to effect this, she must be introduced to you, and after much pondering to find some decorous way of presenting herself, she hit on one. There was a neighboring queen who had been driven out of her dominions by a usurper who had murdered her husband. This unhappy princess was ragging the world to find an asylum and an avenger. The fairy carried her off, and having disposed her in a safe place, put her to sleep and assumed her form. You beheld, sire, that disguised fairy fling herself at your feet and implore your protection and assistance to punish the assassin of a husband whom she professed she regretted as deeply as you did your queen. She protested that her love for him alone impelled her to this course, and that she renounced with all her heart a crown which she offered to him who should avenge her dear husband. The unhappy pity each other. You interested yourself in her misfortunes the more readily for that she wept the loss of her beloved spouse, and that mingling her tears with yours, she talked to you incessantly of the Queen. You gave her your protection, and lost no time in re-establishing her authority in the kingdom she pretended to. By punishing the rebels and the usurper she seemed to desire, but she would neither return to it nor quit you. She implored you for her own security to govern the kingdom in her name, as you were too generous to accept it as a gift from her, and to permit her to reside at your court. You could not refuse her this new favor. She appeared to be necessary to you for the education of your daughter, for the cunning fairy knew well enough that child was the sole object of your affection. She feigned an exceeding fondness for her, and had her continually in her arms. Anticipating the request you were about to make to her, she earnestly begged to be permitted to take charge of her education, saying that she would have no heir but that dear child, whom she looked on as her own, and who was the only being she loved in the world. Because, she said, she reminded her of a daughter she had had by her husband, and who perished along with him. The proposal appeared to you so advantageous that you did not hesitate to entrust the princess to her care, and to give her full authority over her. She acquitted herself of her duties to perfection, and by her talent and her affection obtained your implicit confidence and your love as for a tender sister. This was not sufficient for her. All her anxiety was but to become your wife. She neglected nothing to gain this end, but even had you never been the husband of the most beautiful of fairies, She was not formed to inspire you with love. The shape she had assumed could not bear comparison with hers, into whose place she would have stolen. It was extremely ugly, and being naturally so herself, she had only the power of appearing beautiful one day in the year. The knowledge of this discouraging fact convinced her that to succeed she must have recourse to other charms than those of beauty. She intrigued secretly to oblige the people and the nobility to petition you to take another wife, and to point her out to you as the desirable person. But certain ambiguous conversations she had held with you, in order to sound your inclinations, enabled you easily to discover the origin of the pressing solicitations with which you were importuned. You declared positively that you would not hear of giving a stepmother to your daughter, nor lower her position by making her subordinate to a queen, from that which she held as the highest person next to yourself in the kingdom, and the acknowledged heir to your throne. You also gave the false queen to understand that you should feel obliged by her returning to her own dominions immediately and without ado, and promised her that when she was settled there you would render her all the services she could expect from a faithful friend and a generous neighbor. But you did not conceal from her that if she did not take this course willingly, she ran the risk of being compelled to do so. The invincible obstacle you then opposed to her love threw her into a terrific rage, but she affected so much indifference about the matter that she succeeded in persuading you that her attempt was caused by ambition and the fear that eventually you might take possession of her dominions, preferring, notwithstanding the earnestness with which she had appeared to offer them to you, to let you believe she was insincere in that case, rather than you should suspect her real sentiments. Her fury was not less violent because it was suppressed. Not doubting that it was beauty who, more powerful in your heart than policy, caused you to reject the opportunity of increasing your empire in so glorious a manner, she conceived for her a hatred as violent as that which she felt for your wife, and resolved to get rid of her, fully believing that if she were dead, your subjects, renewing their remonstrances, would compel you to change your state in order to leave a successor to the throne. The good soul was anything but of an age to present you with one, but that she cared little about. The queen, whose resemblance she had assumed, was still young enough to have many children, and her ugliness was no obstacle to a royal and political alliance. Notwithstanding the official declaration you had made, it was thought that if your daughter died, you would yield to the continual representations of your council. It was believed also that your choice would fall upon this pretended queen, and that idea surrounded her with numberless parasites. It was her design, therefore, by the aid of one of her flatterers, whose wife was as base as her husband, and as wicked as she was herself, to make away with your daughter. She had appointed this woman governess to the little princess. These wretches settled between them that they would smother her, and report that she had died suddenly. But for more security, they decided to commit this murder in the neighboring forest, so that nobody could surprise them in the execution of this barbarous deed. They counted on no one having the slightest knowledge of it, and that it would be impossible to blame them for for not having sought for assistance before she expired, having the legitimate excuse that they were too far from any. The husband of the governess proposed to go in search of aid as soon as the child was dead, and that no suspicion might be awakened, he was to appear surprised at finding it too late when he returned to the spot where he had left this tender victim of their fury. And he also rehearsed the sorrow and consternation he was to affect. When my wretched sister saw herself deprived of her power, and condemned to a cruel imprisonment, she requested me to console you and to watch over the safety of her child. It was unnecessary for her to take that precaution. The tie which unites us, and the pity I felt for her, would have sufficed to ensure you my protection, and her entreaties could not increase the zeal with which I hastened to fulfill her decrees. I saw you as often as I could, and as much as prudence permitted me, without incurring the risk of arousing the suspicions of our enemy, who would have denounced me as a fairy in whom sisterly affection prevailed over the honor of her order, and who protected a guilty race. I neglected nothing to convince all the fairies that I had abandoned my sister to her unhappy fate, and by so doing trusted to be more at liberty to serve her. As I watched every movement of your perfidious admirer, not only with my own eyes, but those of a genie, who were my servants, her horrible intentions were not unknown to me. I could not oppose her by open force, and though it would have been easy for me to annihilate those into whose hands she had delivered the little innocent, prudence restricted me. For had I carried off your daughter, the malignant fairy would have retaken her from me, without its being possible for me to defend her. It is a law amongst us that we must be 1,000 years old before we can dispute the power of the ancient fairies, or at any rate we must have become serpents. The perils which accompany the latter condition cause us to call it the terrible act. The bravest amongst us shudder at the thought of undertaking it. We hesitate a long time before we can resolve to expose ourselves to its consequences, and without the urgent motive of hatred, love, or vengeance, there are few who do not prefer waiting for time to make them elders than to acquire their privilege by that dangerous transformation in which the greater number are destroyed. I was in this position. I wanted 10 years of the 1,000, and I had no resource but in artifice. I employed it successfully. I took the form of a monstrous she-bear, and hiding myself in the forest selected for the execution of this detestable deed. When the wretches arrived to fulfill the barbarous order they had received, I flung myself upon the woman who had the child in her arms, and who had already placed her hand on its mouth. Her fright made her drop the precious burden, but she was not allowed to escape so easily. The horror I felt at her unnatural conduct inspired me with the ferocity of the brute I had assumed the form of. I strangled her, as well as the traitor who accompanied her, and I carried off Beauty, after having rapidly stripped off her clothes and dyed them with the blood of her enemies. I scattered them also about the forest, taking the precaution to tear them in several places, so that they should not suspect the princess had escaped, and I withdrew, delighted at having succeeded so completely. The fairy believed her object had been attained. The death of her two accomplices was an advantage to her. She was the mistress of her secret, and the fate they had met with was but what she had herself destined them to, in recompense of their guilty services. Another circumstance was also favourable to her. Some shepherds, who had seen this affair from a distance, ran for assistance, which arrived just in time to see the infamous wretches expire, and prevent the possibility of suspicion that she had any part in it. End of section 24. Section 25 of 4 and 20 Fairy Tales. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Story of the Beauty and the Beast by Madame de Villeneuve, translated by James Loshy. Part 7. The same circumstances were equally favourable to my enterprise. The wicked fairy was fully convinced, as the people by them. The event was so natural that she never doubted it. She did not even condescend to exert her skill to satisfy herself of the fact. I was delighted at her fancied security. I should not have been the strongest had she attempted to recover little Beauty, because, in addition to the reasons which made her my superior, and which I have explained to you, she possessed the advantage of having received that child from you. You had deputed to her your authority, which you alone could reassume, and short of your wresting yourself out of her hands, nothing could interfere with the control she had a right to exercise over the princess till she was married. Preserved from this anxiety, I found myself overwhelmed by another, on recollecting that the mother of the seasons had condemned my niece to marry a monster. But she was then not 3 years old, and I flattered myself I should be able, by study, to discover some expedient to prevent this curse being fulfilled to the letter, and to evade it by some equivocation. I had plenty of time to ponder on it, and my first care was, therefore, only to find some spot where I could place my precious charge in safety. Profound secrecy was absolutely necessary to me. I dared not place her in a castle, nor exercise for her benefit any of the magnificent wonders of our art. Our enemy would have noticed it. It would have awakened an anxiety, the consequences of which would have been fatal to us. I thought it better to assume an humble garb, and confined the infant to the care of the first person I met with, who appeared to me to be an honest man, and under whose roof I could promise myself she would enjoy the comforts of life. Chance soon favoured my intentions. I found what suited me exactly. It was a small house in a village, the door of which was open. I entered this cottage, which appeared to me that of a peasant in easy circumstances. I saw by the light of a lamp 3 country women asleep beside a cradle, which I concluded contained a baby. The cradle did not at all correspond with the general simplicity of the apartment. Everything about it was sumptuous. I imagined that its little occupant was ill, and that the deep sleep into which its nurses had fallen was the consequence of long watching over it. I approached silently, with the intention of curing the infant, and anticipated with pleasure the surprise of these women on awaking to find their invalid restored to health, without knowing what to attribute it to. I was about to take the child out of the cradle in order to breathe health into it, But my good intentions were vain. It expired at the instant I touched it. I immediately conceived the idea of taking advantage of this melancholy event, and substituting my niece for the dead child, which, by good fortune, was also a girl. I lost no time in making the exchange, and, bearing away the lifeless infant, buried it carefully. I then returned to the house, at the door of which I knocked long and loudly to awaken the sleepers. I told them, feigning a provincial dialect, that I was a stranger to those parts, who was in want of a night's lodging. They good naturally offered me one, and then went to look at their nursling, whom they found quietly asleep, with all the appearance of being in perfect health. They were astonished and delighted, not dreaming of the deception I had practiced upon them. They informed me that the child was the daughter of a rich merchant, that one of their party had been her nurse, and after having weaned her, had restored her to her parents. But the child, having fallen ill in her father's house, had been sent back to the country in hope that the change of air would be of service to her. They added, with satisfied countenances, that the experiment had succeeded, and produced a better effect than all the remedies which had been restored to previous to its adoption. They determined to carry her back to her father as soon as it was daylight, in order to afford him, as early as possible, the gratification he would derive from her restoration, for conducing to which, also, they expected to receive a liberal reward, as the child was his particular favorite, although the youngest of 11. At sunrise, they set out, and I feigned to continue my journey, congratulating myself on having so well provided for my niece's safety. To ensure this object more completely, and induce the supposed father still more to attach himself to the little girl, I assumed the form of one of those women who go about telling fortunes, and arriving at the merchant's door, just as the nurses reached it with the child, I followed them into the house. He received them with delight, and taking the little girl in his arms, became the dupe of his parental affection, and fancied that the emotions simply caused by his kindly disposition were the mysterious workings of nature at the sight of his offspring. I seized this opportunity of increasing the interest he believed he had in the child. "Look well upon this little one, my good gentleman," said I, in the usual language of the class to which my dress I appeared to belong. "She will be a great honor to thy family. She will bring thee immense wealth, and save thy life and that of thy children. She will be so beautiful, that she will be called Beauty by all who behold her." As a reward for my prediction, he gave me a piece of gold, and I withdrew, perfectly satisfied. I had no longer any reason for residing with the race of Adam. To profit by my leisure, I returned to Fairyland, resolving to remain in it some time. I passed my days there, quietly in consoling my sister, in giving her news of her dear daughter, and in assuring her that, far from forgetting her, you cherished her memory as fondly as you had formerly herself. Such, great king, was our situation whilst you were suffering under the fresh calamity which had deprived you of your child, and renewed all the affliction you had felt at the loss of her mother. Although you could not positively accuse the person to whom you had confided the infant of being the willful cause of the accident, it was still impossible for you not to look upon her with an evil eye. For though it did not appear that she was guilty of intentional mischief, it was certainly through her neglecting to see that the young Princess was properly attended and protected that the event had proved fatal. After the first paroxysms of your grief had subsided, she flattered herself that no obstacle would arise to prevent your espousing her. She caused her emissaries to renew the proposal to you, but she was undeceived, and her mortification was excessive. When you declared that not only were your intentions unchanged respecting a second marriage, but that even could anything alter your determination, it would never be in her favor. To this declaration you added a positive order for her to quit the kingdom immediately. Her presence continually reminded you of your child, and renewed your affliction. Such was the reason you adduced for this step. But your principal object was to put an end to the intrigues she was constantly carrying on in order to gain her end. She was furious, but she was obliged to obey without being able to avenge herself. I had persuaded one of our ancient fairies to protect you. Her power was considerable, for she joined to her age the advantage of having been four times a serpent, in proportion to the excessive peril incurred by that process, are the honors and powers attached to it. This fairy, out of considerations for me, took you under her protection, and put it out of the power of your indignant lover to do you any mischief. This disappointment was fortunate for the Queen, whose form she had assumed. She awoke her from her magic slumber, and concealing from her the criminal use she had made of her features, placed her conduct in the best light before her. She expatiated on the value of her intercession with the King, and on the trouble she had saved her, and gave her the best advice she could, how to maintain herself for the future in her proper person. It was then to console herself for your indifference. The fairy returned to the young prince and resumed her care of him. She became too fond of him, and not being able to make herself beloved, she caused him to suffer that terrible effect of her fury. In the meanwhile, I had insensibly arrived at the privileged age, and my power was increased. But my desire to serve my sister and yourself induced me to feel that, still, I had not sufficient. My sincere friendship blinding me to the perils of the terrible act, I resolved to undertake it. I became a serpent, and passed fortunately through the ordeal. I was then in a position to act openly in favor of those who were persecuted by my malicious companions, if I cannot at all times entirely dissolve their fatal spells, I can at least counteract them by my skill and by my counsels. My niece was amongst the number of those whom I could not completely favor, not daring to discover all the interest I took in her. It appeared to me that the best thing I could do was to allow her still to pass as the merchant's daughter. I visited her under various forms, and always returned satisfied. Her virtue and beauty equaled her good sense. At the age of 14, she had already given proof of her great fortitude during the changes of fortune which had befallen her supposed father. I was delighted to find that the most cruel reverses had not been able to affect her tranquillity. on the contrary, by her cheerfulness, by the charm of her conversation, she had succeeded in restoring it to the hearts of her father and her brothers. And I rejoiced to observe also that her sentiments were worthy of her birth. These pleasant reflections were, however, mingled with much bitterness, when I remembered that, with so many perfections, she was destined to be the wife of a monster. I toiled, I studied night and day to find some means of saving her from so great a misfortune, and was in despair at finding none. This anxiety did not prevent me, however, from paying occasional visits to you. Your wife, who was deprived of that liberty, implored me incessantly to go and see you, and, notwithstanding the protection of our friend, her affectionate heart was continually alarmed about you, and persuaded her that the instant I lost sight of you would be the last of your life, and in which you would be sacrificed to the fury of our enemy. This fear possessed her so strongly that she scarcely gave me a moment's rest. No sooner did I bring her news of you than she supplicated me so earnestly to return to you that it was impossible to refuse her. Compassionating her anxiety, and more desirous to end it than to save myself the trouble it gave me, I employed against my cruel companion the same weapons she had made use of against you. I proceeded to open the great book. By good fortune, it was at the very moment she was holding that conversation with the Queen and Prince, which terminated in his transformation. I lost not a word of it, and my rapture was extreme at finding that, in seeking to assure her vengeance, she neutralized it, without knowing it, the mischief which the Mother of the Seasons had done us in dooming Beauty to be the bride of a monster. To crown our happiness, she added conditions so advantageous that it almost seemed as if she made them on purpose to oblige me, for she thereby furnished my sister's daughter with an opportunity of proving that she was worthy of being the issue of the purest of fairy blood. The slightest sign or gesture expresses amongst us as much as it would take an ordinary mortal 3 days to explain. I uttered but one contemptuous word. It was enough to inform the assembly that our enemy had pronounced her own sentence in that which she had caused 10 years before to be passed upon your wife. At the age of the latter, the weaknesses of love was more natural than at the advanced period of existence of a fairy of the highest order. I spoke of the base and wicked actions which had accompanied that superannuated passion. I urged that if so many infamous acts were allowed to pass unpunished, mortals would be justified in saying that fairies existed in the world but to dishonor nature and afflict the human race. Presenting the book to them, I condensed this abrupt oration in the single word, "Behold!" It was not the less powerful in its effect. There were present also friends of mine, both young and old, who treated the amorous fury as she deserved. She had not succeeded in becoming your wife, and to that disgrace was now added degradation from her order, and imprisonment, as in the case of the Queen of the Happy Island. This council was held whilst she was with you, madam, and your son. As soon as she appeared amongst us, the result was communicated to her. I had the pleasure to be present. After which, closing the book, I descended rapidly from the middle region of air in which our empire is situated, to compact the effect of the despair to which you were ready to abandon yourselves, I performed my journey in as short a space of time as I had occupied with my laconical address. I arrived soon enough to promise you my assistance. All sorts of reasons combined to invite me. Your virtues, your misfortunes, said the Fairy, turning to the Prince, the advantages they offered to beauty, made me see in you the monster that suited me. You appear to me worthy of each other, and I felt convinced that when you become acquainted, your hearts would do each other mutual justice. You know, she continued, addressing the Queen, what I have since done to attain my object, and by what means I obliged Beauty to come to this palace, where the sight of the Prince and her interviews with him, in the dreams I conjured up for her, had the effect I desired. They kindled love in her heart without diminishing her virtue or weakening the sense of duty and gratitude which attached her to the monster. In short, I have happily brought my scheme to perfection. Yes, Prince, pursued the Fairy, you have no longer anything to fear from your enemy. She is stripped of her power, and will never again be able to injure you by other spells. You have exactly fulfilled the conditions she imposed on you. Had you not done so, you would have been still bound by them, notwithstanding her eternal degradation. You have made yourself beloved without the aid of your rank or your intelligence, and you, Beauty, are equally relieved from the curse pronounced upon you by the Mother of the Seasons. You cheerfully accepted a monster for your husband. She has nothing more to exact. All now tends to your happiness. The Fairy ceased speaking, and the King threw himself at her feet. Great Fairy, he exclaimed, how can I thank you for all the favors you have heaped on my family? My gratitude for the benefits you have bestowed on us far exceeds my power of expression. But, my august sister, added he, that title encourages me to ask more favors, for, despite the obligations I am already under to you, I cannot avoid confessing to you that I shall never be truly happy so long as I am deprived of the presence of my beloved Fairy Queen. This account of what she has done and what she has suffered for me would increase my love and affliction, were either of them capable of being augmented. Ah, madam, he added, can you not crown all your benefactions by enabling me to behold her? The question was useless if the Fairy had had the power to have afforded him that gratification. She was too willing to have waited for the request, but she could not alter what the council of the fairies had decreed. The young queen, being a prisoner in the middle regions of air, there was not the shadow of a chance of his being enabled to see her, and the fairy was about to explain this to him kindly, and to exhort him to await patiently some unforeseen events by which she might take advantage, when an enchanting melody stole upon their ears and interrupted her. The king, his daughter, the queen, and the prince were in ecstasies, but the fairy experienced another sort of surprise. Such music indicated the triumph of some fairy. She could not imagine what fairy had achieved a victory. Her fears suggested that it was the Old One, or the Mother of the Seasons, who in her absence had obtained, the former, her liberty, or the latter, permission to persecute the lovers afresh. She was in this perplexity when it was agreeably ended by the presence of her fairy sister, the Queen of the Happy Island, who suddenly appeared in the centre of that charming group. She was no less lovely than when the King, her husband, lost her. The monarch, who instantly recognized her, making the respect he owed her, yield to the love he had cherished for her, embrace her with such transports of joy that the Queen herself was surprised at them. The fairy, her sister, could not imagine to what fortunate miracle she was indebted for her liberty, but the royal fairy informed her that she owed her happiness solely to her own courage, which had impelled her to hazard her own existence to preserve another's. "You are aware," said she to the fairy, "that the daughter of our queen was received into the order at her birth, that her father was not sublunary being, but the sage Amdabik, whose alliance is an honor to the fairy race, and whose sublime knowledge invests him with much higher powers. Notwithstanding this, however, it was imperative for his daughter to become a serpent at the end of her first 100 years. The fatal period arrived, and our queen, as tender a mother, and as anxious respecting the fate of this dear infant as any ordinary parent could be, could not resolve to expose her to the many chances of destruction in that shape, the misfortunes of those who had perished being but too notorious for her not to feel the greatest alarm. My wretched situation depriving me of all hope of again beholding my affectionate husband and my lovely daughter, I had conceived a perfect disgust for a life which I was doomed to pass apart from them. Without the least hesitation, therefore, I offered to become a crawling reptile in the place of the young fairy. I saw with delight a certain, prompt, and honorable mode of delivering myself from all the miseries with which I was overwhelmed, by death or by a glorious emancipation, which would render me mistress of my own actions, and thereby enable me to rejoin my husband." Our queen hesitated as little to accept this offer, so gratifying to her maternal affection, as I did to make it. She embraced me 100 times, and promised to restore me to liberty unconditionally, and re-establish me in all my privileges, if I was fortunate enough to pass unharmed through that perilous enterprise. I did do so, and the fruit of my labors was enjoyed by the young fairy, for whom I had been the substitute. The success of my first trial encouraged me to make a second for my own benefit. I underwent the transformation anew, and was equally fortunate. This last act made me an elder, and consequently independent. I was not long in profiting by my liberty, and flying hither to rejoin a family so dear to me. As soon as the fairy had finished her narrative, the embraces were renewed by her affectionate auditors. It was a charming confusion, in which each caressed the other, almost without knowing what they were about. Beauty, particularly enchanted at appertaining to such an illustrious family, and no longer fearing to degrade the prince, her cousin, by causing him to form an alliance beneath him. But although transported by the excess of her happiness, she did not forget the worthy man whom she had formerly believed to be her father. She recalled to her fairy aunt the promise she had made to her, that he and his children should have the honor of being present at her marriage. She was still speaking to her on this subject when they saw from the window 16 persons on horseback, most of whom had hunting horns, and appeared in considerable confusion, their disorder evidently arose from their horses having ran away with them. Beauty instantly recognized them as the six sons of the worthy merchant, the five daughters, and their five lovers. Everybody but the Fairy was surprised at this abrupt entrance. Those who made it were not less so, at finding themselves carried by the speed of their unmanageable horses into a palace totally unknown to them. This is the way it happened. They were all out hunting, when their horses, suddenly uniting themselves as in one squadron, galloped off with them at such speed to the palace that all their efforts to stop them were perfectly useless. Beauty, thoughtless of her present dignity, hastened to receive and reassure them. She embraced them all kindly. The good man himself next appeared, but not in the same disorder. A horse had neighed and scratched at his door. He had no doubt that it came to seek him by order of his dear daughter. He mounted him without fear, and perfectly satisfied as to whither the steed would bear him, he was not at all surprised to find himself in the courtyard of a palace which he now saw for the third time, and to which he felt convinced he had been conducted to witness the marriage of Beauty and the Beast. The moment he perceived her, he ran to her with open arms, blessing the happy moment that presented her again to his sight, and heaping benedictions on the generous Beast who had permitted him to return. He looked about for him in every direction, to offer him his most humble thanks for all the favors he had heaped on his family, and particularly on his youngest daughter. He was vexed at not seeing him, and began to apprehend that his conjectures were erroneous. Still, the presence of all his children seemed to support the idea he had formed, as they would scarcely have been all assembled in that spot if some solemn ceremony, such as that marriage, were not to be celebrated. These reflections, which the good man made to himself, did not prevent him from pressing Beauty fondly in his arms, and bathing her cheek with tears of joy, after allowing due time for this first expression of his feelings. "Enough, good man," said the Fairy. "You have sufficiently caressed this princess. It is time that, ceasing to regard her as a father, you should learn that that title does not appertain to you, and that you must now do her homage as your sovereign. She is the Princess of the Happy Island, daughter of the King and Queen whom you see before you. She is about to become the wife of this prince. Here stands the prince's mother, sister of the king. I am a fairy, her friend, and the aunt of Beauty. As to the prince," added the Fairy, observing the expression of the good man's face, "he is better known to you than you imagine, but he is much altered since you last saw him. In a word, he was the Beast himself." The father and his sons were enchanted at these wonderful tidings, while the sisters felt a painful jealousy, but they endeavored to conceal it under the mask of gratification, which deceived no one. The others, however, feigned to believe them sincere. As to the lovers who had been rendered inconstant by the hope of possessing Beauty, and who had only returned to their first attachments on their despairing to obtain her, they knew not what to think. The merchant could not help weeping without being able to tell whether his tears were caused by the pleasure of seeing the happiness of Beauty, or by the sorrow of losing so perfect a daughter. His sons were agitated by similar feelings. Beauty, extremely affected by this evidence of their love, entreated those on whom she now depended as well as the Prince, her future husband, to permit her to reward such tender attachment. Her entreaty testified the goodness of her heart too sincerely not to be listened to. They were laden with bounties, and by permission of the King, the Prince, and the Queen, Beauty continued to call them by the tender names of father, brothers, and even sisters, though she was not ignorant that the latter were as little so in heart as they were in blood. She desired they would all in return call her by the name they were wont to do when they believed her to be a member of their family. The old man and his children were appointed to offices in the court of Beauty, and enjoyed the pleasure of living continually near her, in a station sufficiently exalted to be generally respected. The lovers of her sisters, whose passion for Beauty might easily have been revived, if they had not known it would be useless, thought themselves too happy in being united to the good man's daughters, and becoming allied to persons for whom Beauty retained so much goodwill. All those she desired to be present at her wedding having arrived, the celebration of it was no longer delayed. The festivities lasted many days, and ended at length only because the fairy aunt of the young bride pointed out to them the propriety of leaving that beautiful retreat and returning to their dominions to show themselves to their subjects. It was quite time she should recall their kingdom to their recollection, and the indispensable duties which demanded their presence. Enraptured with the scenes around them, entranced by the pleasure of loving and expressing their love to each other, they had entirely forgotten their royal state and the cares that attend it. The newly married pair indeed proposed to the fairy that they should abdicate and resign their power into the hands of anyone she should select. But that wise being represented to them clearly that they were under as great an obligation to fulfill the destiny which had confided to them the government of a nation, as that nation was to preserve for them an unshaken loyalty. They yielded to these just remonstrances, but the Prince and Beauty stipulated that they should be allowed occasionally to visit that spot, and cast aside for a while the cares inseparable from their station, and that they should be awaited on by the invisible genie or the animals who had attended them during the preceding years. They availed themselves as often as possible of this liberty. Their presence seemed to embellish the spot. All were eager to please them. The genie awaited their visits with impatience and received them with joy, testifying in a hundred ways the delight their return afforded them. The fairy, whose foresight neglected nothing, gave them a chariot drawn by 12 white stags with golden horns and hoofs like those she drove herself. The speed of these animals was almost greater than that of thought, and drawn by them, you could easily make the tour of the world in 2 hours. By these means, they lost no time in traveling. They profited by every moment of leisure, and went frequently in this elegant equipage to visit their father, the King of the Happy Island, who had grown so young again through the return of his fairy queen, that he equaled in face and form the Prince, his son-in-law. He felt also equally happy, being neither less enamored nor less eager to prove to his wife his unceasing affection, while she, on her part, responded to his love with all that tenderness which had previously been the cause of so much misfortune to her. She had been received by her subjects with transports of joy as great as those of grief, which her loss had occasioned them. She had always loved them dearly, and her will being now unfettered, she proved as much by showering upon them for many centuries all the benefits they could desire. Her power, assisted by the friendship of the Queen of the Fairies, preserved the life, health, and youth of the King, her husband, for ages. He only ceased to exist because no mortal can live forever. The Queen and the Fairy, her sister, were equally attentive to Beauty. Her husband, the Queen, his mother, the old man, and all his family, so that there never was known people who lived so long. The Queen, mother of the Prince, caused this marvelous history to be recorded in the archives of her kingdom and in those of the Happy Island, that it might be handed down to posterity. They also disseminated copies of it throughout the universe, so that the world at large might never cease to talk of the wonderful adventures of Beauty and the Beast. End of section 25.
Section 26 of 4 and 20 Fairy Tales. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Betty B. Princess Minute and King Floridor by Count de Caylus. Translated by James Planchet.
Princess Minute and King Floridor.
There was, once upon a time, a king and queen who died young, and left a very fine empire to the princess, their only daughter, who was then but 13 years of age. She imagined that she knew how to reign, and all her good subjects persuaded themselves into the same idea, without well knowing why. However, it is a profession which is not without its difficulties. The king and queen had at least the consolation, when dying, of leaving the princess, their daughter, under the protection of a friendly fairy. She was called Myrdadin, and was a very good woman, but she added to the defect of allowing herself to be prejudiced that of obstinacy in continuing so. As for the little princess, she was so very diminutive that they called her Minute. Thus was this fine kingdom governed by prejudice and frivolity, for the princess had never been corrected in the taste which she showed for trifles, and it was for her that all these little knick-knacks were invented, with which we have since been overwhelmed. This princess exhibited the grandeur of her ideas by an act which I will select from a thousand such. She would not retain as general of her forces, nay, even exiled from her court, a veteran distinguished for the services which he had rendered the state. And why? Because he had appeared in her presence with a hat bound with silver, when his coat was laced with gold. She thought that a man who could be guilty of such negligence at court would be also, for the same reason, very capable of allowing himself to be surprised by the enemy. The discernment which she flattered herself as having shown in this instance, and the sound judgment which the fairy distinguished in her most frivolous ideas, proved the existence of a delusion which would have been enough to turn a stronger head. There was near this great country a little kingdom, so very small that I hardly know what to compare it to. A queen mother had for a long time reigned over it in the name of Prince Floridor, but this good queen died. Floridor, who was the most affectionate son possible, felt this loss acutely, and always retained a feeling of gratitude for the obligations he was unto her. One of the greatest was a perfect education, the most perfect, the most rigid, as far as concerned the body, which had rendered him as robust as active, and the mildest with regard to his mind, to which she had given both accomplishments and solidity. This young prince was handsome and well-formed. He governed wisely, without abusing his despotic power. His desires were well regulated. In a word, he would have been an amiable person in private life. His subjects adored him, and the strangers who visited at the court agreed that he would have conferred happiness on the greatest empire. But one thing they were not aware of was that he owed to a charming aunt a great number of his advantages. She had been attached to him from his infancy. At the death of the queen, the good aunt was his sole consolation. He took no single step without going previously to consult this aunt in a wood in the palace gardens, which she had chosen as her residence. He often abandoned the court and its pleasures to go and converse with her. No weather prevented his presenting himself to her, and however severe might be the winter, she always came out of her anthill, which was the best regulated for 100 miles round, and gave him advice full of prudence and wisdom. You may easily have guessed that the pretty aunt of whom we speak was a fairy. Her history, which dates back 7,000 years, will be found brought down to the 22,000th year of the world at the 460th page of the volume for that year. It would therefore have been easy for this aunt to give the king, whom she loved so well, several kingdoms, for fairies dispose of them at their own pleasure. But the aunt was prudent, and prudence is always guided by justice. It was not that she did not heartily desire the advancement of Floridor, but she wished him to employ no means to obtain it but those that might increase the true glory with the love of which she had inspired his heart. The aunt was naturally patient. She waited for an opportunity to bring to light the virtues of her pupil. The conduct of Minute and the prejudice of Mirdaden soon furnished her with one. They were informed that the flame of revolt was kindled in the mighty kingdom of Minute. When this news had been confirmed by all the newspapers, the good fairy aunt desired King Floridor to set out, attended by a simple groom, to assist the queen, his neighbor. She gave him at parting nothing but a common sparrow, a little knife, which is usually called a jambette, and a walnut shell. "My gifts," said she, "appear mean, but make yourself easy respecting them. They will be of service in your need, and I hope you will be satisfied with them." He readily assured her of that confidence which her former favors had rendered it, but just that he should place in her, and having bidden her tenderly farewell, he set out on his journey, every inhabitant of his little kingdom regretting his departure as much as if he had been a brother, a son, or a bosom friend. He arrived in the capital of Queen Minute's dominions. He found it in a state of commotion, as they had heard that a neighboring king was advancing rapidly, followed by a terrible army. He was coming with the design of seizing the kingdom. Floridor learnt that the queen had retired to a delightful residence she possessed near the capital, and in which she had collected all sorts of brilliant gewgaws. She had, however, a motive for this retirement. She wished to consider seriously and decide, without being interrupted, whether the troops which the fairy had ordered to be levied to oppose the usurper should wear blue or white cockades. The queen was, notwithstanding, at this time 20 years of age. King Floridor, having ascertained the road which led to this country house, proceeded there with all speed. His handsome face prejudiced Mirdaden in his favor. The compliments which he paid to the queen and her only increased the good opinion which his first appearance had inspired her with, and the offer of his services was all the better received, as the state was in a very embarrassed situation. Minute appeared to Floridor to be charming. From that moment the king fell desperately in love. The zeal and alacrity always inseparable from that passion were displayed in his words and actions, and shone in his eyes, and it was with extreme care he investigated the existing position of affairs. He wished to have recourse to the powers of fairyland, but the blind prejudice of Mirdaden had induced her long before to give her wand to Minute, with the idea of amusing her, and that princess had made such a prodigal use of it that it was worn out, and had neither strength nor virtue, particularly for important things. Floridor returned to the capital, but found there neither fortifications nor munitions of war. Meanwhile, the invader advanced nearer and nearer. Floridor saw only a rival in the person of the hostile king, and finding no other resource, he was obliged to propose to the queen to take flight, offering her with pride an asylum in his dominions. Prudence suggested to him a line of conduct which his courage condemned, but it was necessary to save an unhappy sovereign, and he only made this proposition on condition of his being allowed to return and expose himself to every danger, and use every effort to restore to the queen a throne which so legitimately belonged to her. The moment he had placed her person in safety in his little kingdom, Mir Dedan, convinced by all the king represented to her, accepted the proposition, but the queen only consented to depart when they promised her that the horse she was to ride should have a rose-colored harness, and Floridor had agreed to present her with the sparrow which the fairy aunt had given him on his leaving her. The bird was soon given, but though the departure was urgent, they had to wait till a harness, such as the queen wished for, could be procured from the city. It came at length, and Floridor and Minute, with no other suite but Mir Dedan, took the road to the king's dominions. Floridor was enchanted at being allowed to conduct Minute to his own kingdom, and at believing himself to be useful to her he adored. To be in love and a traveller are two things which make people exceedingly talkative. Floridor, in announcing the limited extent of his states, at which he sometimes blushed, could not refrain from speaking of the obligations he owed to the good aunt. When he came, however, to the details of their parting, the walnut, the little knife, and the sparrow appeared to the queen very singular presents. She was very anxious to see the walnut. The king gave it to her without any scruples. As soon as it was in her hands, she cried, "Heavens, what do I hear?" She put her ear to it with the utmost attention, and then said, with surprise mingled with curiosity, "I hear very distinctly little voices of men, neighing of horses, trumpets, in short, a singular murmur. This is the prettiest thing in the world," she exclaimed. While the king was himself occupied by that which amused her whom he loved, he perceived the scouts of the revolted army close upon them, and consequently ready to take them prisoners. At this perilous moment, by an involuntary movement, he broke the walnut, and out of it he saw issue 30,000 effective men, horse, foot, and dragoons, with artillery and all the necessary munitions of war. He placed himself at their head, and showing a bold front to the enemy, he made, without ever striking a blow, the most beautiful retreat in the world. He took possession in this way of the mountains he found on his road, and saved the queen from the hands of her rebellious subjects. After this fine military maneuver, which was not accomplished without much fatigue, and alarm at the danger the queen had incurred, they halted several days on the mountain. But as all the country was up in arms, they perceived, on recommencing their march, another army, much more numerous than that which they had escaped, and which it would have been the height of rashness to give battle to. In this cruel situation, the queen asked for the little knife, which the aunt had given to him, to use for some trifling purpose. But finding that it did not cut to her fancy, she threw it away, saying, "There's a pleasant knife." The moment it touched the ground, it made a considerable hole in it. The king was struck with the talent of his jambette, and immediately cut with it deep entrenchments all around the mountain, which rendered their position impregnable. When this operation was finished, which only occupied him the time necessary to make the circuit, the sparrow he had presented to Minute took wing and flew to the summit of the mountain. Then, flapping its wings, it cried in a terrible voice, "Leave me alone to deal with them. You are about to see a fine game. Let all descend the mountain, march upon the enemy, and fear nothing." He was instantly obeyed, and the sparrow raised the mountain as easily as if it had been a straw, and traversing the air with it, he let it fall upon the army of the enemy, crushing, no doubt, the greater part of them. The rest took flight and left the passage free. The king, who was solely occupied with the desire of seeing the queen in safety, was anxious to put the horses to their speed, but as the march of an army is necessarily slow, he would have been glad if it had re-entered the walnut shell. Hardly had he formed the wish when it actually did so. He put it in his pocket, and they arrived in the little kingdom, where the good aunt received them with every mark of sincere friendship. When Floridor had made every arrangement for the accommodation of Minute, and was satisfied that she could want for nothing in the palace, he began to think of his departure, and he did so more cheerfully as the good aunt assured him of her attention to all that concerned the queen. During the journey he had lately performed, and the short time he had passed in his own dominions, he had taken the opportunity of declaring his passion to Minute, which she had been kind enough to approve. At length he was obliged to leave her. Their adieus were tender, and Floridor set out with no other assistance but that of a letter from Minute, addressed to her good and faithful subjects, in which she required them to obey the commands of King Floridor implicitly. The good aunt neither gave him the walnut nor the little knife, which he had returned to her when he came back. The queen only begged him to accept from her hand the sparrow which he had given her, praying that he would always carry it about with him, as well as a scarf of nonpareil, which she had herself made for him. The king followed exactly the same road that he had taken in conducting the queen, not only because lovers are gratified by seeing again the places which are associated in their memories with those whom they love, but because it was also the shortest cut. When he was near the transplanted mountain, the sparrow, rising in the air, took it up with the same facility as before, and carried it back to the spot which it had formerly occupied. The sparrow then, in that terrible voice which he knew how to assume when he wished, said to those whom he found shut up under the mountain, "Be faithful to Minute, and do what King Floridor shall command you in her name." This singular sparrow then disappeared. The mountain, it seems, was hollow, so those who had found themselves enclosed in it were as if under a bell. They had wanted for nothing during the time of their imprisonment. All the soldiers and officers who saw the light of day again with the utmost pleasure ran in crowds to Floridor, whose handsome countenance interested them, and looking upon him as a demigod, they were ready to worship him. The king, moved by their obedience and the new vows of fidelity to the lawful queen, which they took at his hands, received their respects, but not their adoration, after having shown them the letter with which he was charged. He made the army pass in review, and chose from it 50,000 of the finest men, and of those to whose devotion a general success is mostly due. He established in his new army a very strict discipline, of which he was both the author and example, and it was with these troops that he became invincible, that he defied the countless forces of the usurper, whom he slew with his own hand in one of the last battles, and whose death restored to Minute a kingdom which he had entirely lost. Floridor marched through all the provinces of this great state, and re-established the authority of Minute, whom he then hastened to rejoin. But what a change did he find in the character and mind of this lovely queen! The counsels of the good aunt, and above all, love and the wish to please and be worthy of Floridor, had completely corrected her only fault. She was ashamed of having always done little things with great assistance, whilst her lover had done such great things with so little. They married and lived happily ever after. End of section 26.